Good afternoon, sir. With your permission, can we start the session, sir?
You're asking me?
Sir, please, sir.
Please, please.
Yes,
Jolly
sir.
well, jolly well. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Arnav, please. Arnav?
Yes. Good afternoon, one and all. The Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, Government of India, in association with the UNDP, under the GOI-GEF Secure Himalaya Project, is fortunate to organize a series of webinars as a part of the celebrations of Wildlife Week 2021. This also marks the celebrations of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, commemorating 75 years of India's independence. Today, we host the first of the webinars on strengthening CITES implementation in high-altitude Himalaya. Through a series of deliberations, talks, and panel discussions, today's webinar will focus on the existing mechanisms for CITES implementation and will also highlight the role of various enforcement agencies to fulfill the commitments of the treaty. We are really grateful to the ADG Wildlife, Government of India, to grace us with his presence in this webinar. Thank you, sir. It gives us immense pleasure to invite Ms. Tilottama Verma, the Additional Director of Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, Government of India. Madam is an Indian Police Service officer of 1990 batch belonging to the Uttar Pradesh cadre and presently working as the Additional Director of WCCB. I cordially invite her for her welcome remarks on today's webinar. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Arnav. Thank you very much. A very good afternoon to all. I welcome you all to our webinar series, which is a joint effort of Wildlife Crime Control Bureau and the United Nations Development Programme as part of Wildlife Week as well as the 75th Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. At the outset, I would like to welcome our Additional Director General of Forest, Shri Soumitra Das Gupta, who has kindly consented for the inaugural address. I thank you, sir. I welcome Mr. Rajesh Rawat, Director, Export Promotion Council for Handicrafts, and other panel members, as well as we have some from the farmers community also, as well as those who have joined us today. We have also a speaker from the WCCB. Arvind, I welcome you today also to the session. The first webinar today is on the topic Strengthening CITES Implementation in High-Altitude Himalayas. The international wildlife trade, worth billions of dollars annually, has been responsible for massive declines in the number of many species of animals and plants. The scale of overexploitation for trade aroused such concern for the survival of the species that an international treaty was drawn up in the year 1973 to protect wildlife against such overexploitation and to prevent international trade from threatening species with extinction. Known as the CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora, entered into force on the 1st of July 1975, and now has more than 183 member countries. These countries act by banning commercial trade in an agreed list of currently endangered species and by regulating and monitoring trade in others that might become endangered. The Government of India signed this convention in July 1974 and ratified the convention in July 1976 and became a party to the convention from October 18, 1976. Over the past 46 years, CITES has been setting up rules and procedures for conservation and sustainable use. CITES is one of the oldest conventions in the area of wildlife conservation, which has proven to be flexible and able to cope with new global environmental challenges. Its vision is that by 2020, all international trade in wild fauna and flora is legal and sustainable, consistent with the long-term conservation of species, and thereby contributing to halting biodiversity loss, to ensuring its sustainable use, and to achieving the 2020 Agenda for Sustainable Development. It also, one of its charter is also, which says demand reduction strategies to combat illegal trade in CITES listed species, thereby developing strategies to reduce demand for illegal products of wild animals and plants through demand reduction campaigns, and to enhance, as appropriate, policy, legislation and law enforcement in this regard. It also says that on the World Wildlife Day, and that is today, we, as part of the week, World by our annual Wildlife Week, we probably are also doing what was expected on the World Wildlife Day. That is, the CITES is calling upon all parties to use World Wildlife Day as an opportunity to celebrate and raise the awareness of general public regarding the world's wild animals and plants, to enhance efforts to enforce wildlife protection laws, and to reduce demand for illegally traded wild animals and plants, and to recognize the contribution of wildlife to the livelihoods of poor rural communities in various ways. It is part of this endeavor that in the Wildlife Week, commencing from the 2nd of October, we carry forward this message of protection of wildlife through these webinar series. Once again, I'm grateful to each and everybody who's a participant here or have joined us. And I'm again, once again, grateful to our ADG, particularly for taking out time from his very, very busy schedule. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am, for the kind and warm welcome remarks and for setting the tone for today's webinar. Moving forward, it is my honor to invite Sri Soumitra Das Gupta, the Additional Director General Wildlife and Director Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, Government of India. Sir is an officer of the 1989 batch of Indian Forest Service and belongs to the West Bengal Cadre. Sir has a vast experience of serving across various wildlife habitats of West Bengal and has ably guided the management of the wildlife habitats all across the nation. Sir has been in our country for years. As the ADG Wildlife, Sir also holds the office for the CITES Management Authority of India. It is my utmost honor to request Sir to bless this occasion with his inaugural address. Welcome, sir, over to you.
Thank you, Urjaswi. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So, first of all, I must congratulate and extend my thanks to the WCCB officials, especially Ms. Tilottama Verma, for organizing a series of webinar during the Wildlife Week. This is a very important occasion where we all come together for reinforcing our commitment to the wildlife conservation. Now, speaking regarding the subject, as you all will be knowing and you have already been told to some extent by Ms. Verma, that the illegal trade in wildlife is estimated to be valued anywhere between $7 to $23 billion annually. In this context, wildlife crime represents as one of the major threats to the health of our planet. Since, again, you all know, it's a direct driver of biodiversity loss and species extinction. This affects negatively the local communities who depend on the natural resources. It also affects the ability of countries to sustainably and legally trade in biodiversity. According to reports of organizations such as Interpol and the UN Organization on Drugs and Crime, the international illegal wildlife trade is supposedly linked to transnational organized crime. And we have also some report that in some cases it has also been linked to insurgent groups. Wildlife crime, therefore, may have implications for rule of law as well as security and peace. As again, you all know that India is one of the world's mega biodiverse country and is therefore a major target as a source country for the international illegal wildlife trade. Many species which are in demand in illegal wildlife trade are found in the Himalaya region. The region where the project Secure Himalayas is being implemented. These include tiger, leopard, snow leopard, clouded leopard, Himalayan brown bear, Tibetan antelope, red panda, to name a few. Additionally, the high altitude Himalayas is also home to other important fauna such as Hangul, Markhor, Himalayan marmot, etc. These are all in danger due to illegal activities by some nefarious elements. In India, all these species that I have named are protected through the Wildlife Protection Act. But many of the species that I have named are in demand in the illegal wildlife trade in the Himalayan region. Though they are protected in the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, still we believe that certain stricter provisions must be there, which is in consonance to the directives of the CITES. CITES, as of now, is being implemented in India through the Customs Act 1962, the foreign trade policy notified under the Foreign Trade Act 1992. The Wildlife Protection Act is enforced in the country by the various state government and union territories. Though initially, or the first responsibility for law enforcement in the forest areas goes to the Forest Department, but the police department are also empowered to make seizures and arrests under the Act. The customs authorities are the primary enforcement authority for CITES as of now. Border patrolling forces do play an important role in preventing and detecting wildlife crime. But after 2006, the scenario in the wildlife crime control has been there with a sea change with the advent of the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, which plays a significant role in coordinating the work of all these enforcement agencies, as well as highlighting the importance of controlling wildlife crime. I must put on record the work that has been done the past few years under the stewardship of Ms. Verma is exemplary. And this sort of activity should keep on happening in order to maintain the restraint that we could unleash for wildlife crime. Despite stringent laws and enforcement measures, wildlife crime is still a problem in some parts of the country. Much of the demand for illegal wildlife product comes from East and Southeast Asia and some of our Himalayan region also. The significant route used by the smugglers to transport wildlife contraband out of the country is perhaps also known to many of us. India's neighboring countries like Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, and China are all parties to CITES.
Each with their own implementing legislation. Sorry. Just a minute.
Extremely sorry, yeah. Cracking down on transboundary wildlife crime requires cooperation and coordination. So all these countries need to come together to actually thwart and stop wildlife crime. Apart from bilateral cooperation that we seek most of the time between two countries, and we believe that it is necessary, organizations such as Interpol, the recently created SAWEND, and the CITES Secretariat can play an important role to facilitate such coordination. Ladies and gentlemen, India is on the verge, though late, including CITES in its national wildlife law. It is important also that the law enforcement agencies and other stakeholders are trained properly for exercising the CITES provisions. Here, I would like to conclude by extending my best wishes for the program that the WCCB has charted out for the upcoming week. And I say to all of you, a happy Wildlife Week ahead. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the warm inaugural remarks. It is always a pleasure to listen to you. Thank you so much for gracing the event with your kind presence, sir. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our first speaker of the day, Sri Rajesh Rawat, the Director of the Export Promotion Council for Handicrafts. Sri Rawat has worked in the National Center for Trade Information, a Government of India enterprise, for 7 years and thereafter joined the Export Promotion Council for Handicrafts, EPCH, and is currently working as the Director in EPCH. He was also the first CEO of Handicrafts and Carpet Sector Skill Council under the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship from December 2013 till August 2016. He has worked extensively on the topics of timber legality, brand image promotion programs, and many others. It is my utmost pleasure to hand over the virtual floor to Sri Rajesh Rawat for his session on the implementation of CITES Vriksh Certificate. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Basu. Thank you very much. To begin with, I would like to thank Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, Madam Verma, Mr. Subhadra Das Gupta, for giving me an opportunity to be amongst such esteemed panelists and share my thoughts on how the Vriksh Timber Legality Assessment and Verification Scheme of the EPCH has evolved over the years. So to begin with, I would like to give you a brief overview of what EPCH is all about. Export Promotion Council for Handicrafts is an apex organization in the country engaged in promotion of exports of handicrafts. Now, as you all know, handicrafts are a cluster-based activity, and if you go across the country, you'll find clusters everywhere. So there are over 2,000 clusters, and to name a few, like you have got Moradabad, which is a metalware cluster. If you go to Jodhpur, Saharanpur, they are woodware clusters. If you go to Panipat, which is in carpet and textiles, down south, Narsapur is a lace craft cluster, Bangalore and around areas are Agarbatti cluster, and so on and so forth. So we have around over 10,000 member exporters who are linked with us, and there are over 7 million artisans who are engaged in the country in production of handicrafts. As far as exports is concerned, over 25,000 crores of exports is done annually, and predominantly our export goes to the affluent markets of USA, European Union, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, South Korea, Middle East, and so on and so forth. So this is briefly what EPCH is all about and what exports figures are. Now, as far as Vriksh, Indian Timber Legality Assessment and Verification Scheme is concerned, see what happened in 2013 was the coming of EUTR, European Union Timber Regulation. Now, what happened at that time was that as far as EUTR is concerned, there was a fear amongst the trading exporters that the exports are going to hamper because of that EUTR. But what EUTR indicated or mentions in its charter, it says that the onus of proving that any wooden handicraft item or wooden product which is imported into a European country, the onus of proving that the wood which has been used in production of that particular wooden handicraft item is on the buyer. So the onus is on the buyer to prove the legality of the wood. So since the buyer is the key stakeholder who is procuring good into the European Union, that buyer approached the exporters and said that there has to be some mechanism through which the legality of the wood is to be ascertained, and then only the trade between the buyer and the exporter can happen. However, clearly stated in that UTR thing that exports is not going to hamper in any which way. So the exporters approached us since they are our members, and we had consultations with Ministry of Commerce, Ministry of Textiles, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and DGFT came out with a notification in 2013, which clearly states that in case Export Promotion Council for Handicrafts is authorized to issue a certificate on demand on the due diligence adopted by exporters to procure in procurement of wood from legal sources. So this was the notification which came out in 2013. Now this led to the scheme which we formulated, which is called BRICS Indian Timber Legality Assessment and Verification Scheme, wherein specific standards were created, and we have a governing council of the BRICS in which a lot of senior foresters, industry stakeholders, government officers, they are there in that BRICS governing council, and time to time the meeting of the BRICS happens, which is both the governing council and the technical council. There is a third party audit which happens, wherein the third party auditor audits the company, and based on the satisfactory auditor report, the company is allotted the BRICS certificate. Now this went on from 2000 till 2016. Now what happened in 2016, as all our esteemed panelists know, that in the COP17 meeting, there was this notification, CITES notification, wherein the Dalbergia species were moved from Appendix 3 to the Appendix 2 of the CITES. Now, what happens when a species moves into an Appendix 2? It says that the trade can happen in those particular species, but it has the goods has to accompany the CITES permit. So that happened in 2016, a notification which came out in November. Now, again, the challenge is the exporters said that, I mean, since there's a good amount of export that is happening in case of sisham wood, items made out of sisham wood. In case of sisham wood, hence we need to do something about what has happened through this notification. Now, since the entire Dalbergia species, what has happened in 2016, the COP17 meeting, is that some of the custom officials in, say, Latin American countries said that they are not able to identify the Dalbergia species one from the other. And hence, they want all the Dalbergia species. We all know that there are over 200 species under Dalbergia category. And the two species which got affected were only two species, which is Dalbergia sisu and Dalbergia latifolia. So these two species got placed in the Appendix 2 of the CITES. And what India did was, we again had consultation with Ministry of Textiles and Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and we filed for reservation in 2017 that India wants to opt out of this. And based on that reservation, they accepted our reservation. And once the reservation was accepted, EPCH was asked, since the BRICS scheme was in place, the ecosystem was there in existence, they said, why not EPCH being the nodal agency as far as handicrafts exports are concerned, why not they be allowed to issue not a CITES permit, but a comparable document in lieu of a CITES permit. So EPCH was made an assistant CITES management authority. And since 2017 onwards, we have been issuing BRICS shipment certificate. We call it a BRICS shipment certificate. It's not a CITES permit, it's a comparable document under the umbrella of BRICS. Now what happens is, one has to be a member of the council. Once he's a member of the council, he can go in for a BRICS certification, which is the umbrella certificate, wherein the audit of the company, complete audit of the company happens through a third party audit. Now, once that is done, and then if he has a shipment of, say, sisham, which is to be sent, and then a BRICS shipment certificate per shipment wise is issued to a party. Now again, the complete audit happens. The entire chain of custody documents are procured. Then physical examination happens. Samples are drawn, and then based on the findings, the brick shipment certificates are issued to the exporters. Now this is going on. As far as Dalbajia latifolia exports are concerned, as you all know, rosewood, in case of rosewood, the certificates need to accompany an LPC, which is legal procurement certificate, which is issued by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So once the LPC is issued, then only either a CITES permit or a brick shipment certificate can be issued in case of rosewood production. So this is what is happening since 2017. And we have around 20,000 shipment certificates we issued so far, and we have over 600 member exporters who are under the umbrella of VRICS, and they are all VRICS certified exporters. And whenever there's a need for shipment of a Dalbajia Shishu certification, they approach us and the certificate is issued to them. So this is how the system has evolved, and we are there working on this. Now, one more thing happened was that in a COP18 meeting, as you all know, must be knowing it, there was a proposal we submitted in the COP18 at Geneva, wherein the entire MOEFCC team was there, and we wanted to delist this item from the Appendix 2 of the CITES, and we tried our best. The proposal was there, but since a CITES is a multilateral body, there has to be a consensus, there has to be a there's a voting system in place, and wherein you need to have a 2/3 majority to get anything amended in the CITES appendices list. So we missed out on that, but the COP19 meeting is due, which is next year, so probably we can try again. So this is what the ecosystem of BRICS and BRICS system, the BRICS shipment certificate system that we have been working on for the last 7-8 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for this interesting and captivating session. With this, I would like to take the opportunity to introduce our next speaker, Sri Arvind Kumar Charasia. Sri Arvind Kumar Charasia is an officer from 2010 batch of the Indian Revenue Service. Sri Charasia has worked in the Indian Customs in various capacities from the year 2012 to 2015, following which he has also worked in the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence from 2015 to 2019. He is presently working as Deputy Director in WCCB headquarters and holding additional charge of Regional Deputy Director and Assistant Management Authority CITES, WCCB Northern Region. Today, Sri Arvind Kumar Charasia will be addressing the gathering on the existing mechanisms for CITES implementation in high altitude Himalaya and key gap areas, including information regarding hotspots, modus operandi, and trade route for CITES species being traded illegally. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Jaspi, and very good afternoon to all. I'll share my screen for the presentation. Yeah, so this is the outline of the presentation. First introduction to CITES, then how CITES is implemented. The third point will be Himalayan CITES listed fauna that are in trade. And the next point will be Himalayan CITES listed flora that are in trade. Then the local trade of Himalayan the aromatic and medicinal plants. Then the next point is regarding cyber trafficking of CITES listed flora. And the final point will be regarding the best international practices for CITES implementation. So as our additional director madam has already talked about CITES, so this is the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. And this convention is also known as the Washington Convention, because The CITES Convention was signed in the Washington, D.C. in the United States on the 3rd March of 1973 and which entered into force on the 1st July of 1975. And the main goal of CITES is to ensure that the international trade in the wild animals and plants is legal, sustainable, as well as the traceable, and it doesn't threaten the survival of the species in the wild. And CITES accords varying degrees of protection to almost more than 36,000 of species of animal and plants, which have been categorized into three appendix. So appendix one consists of almost 3% of these 36,000 species of animals and plants. And in this appendix one, those species are covered which are facing the threat of the extinction. And in all these species which are covered under the appendix one, international commercial trade is generally prohibited. And in exceptional circumstances like the zoo transfer, the appendix one species can be transferred between the parties of CITES Convention. And then the appendix two contains almost 97% of the 36,000 species of animals and plants that are covered under the CITES. And in this appendix, those species are covered which are not necessarily threatened with the extinction, but if their international trade is not regulated, they may face the threat of extinction. And the appendix three contains almost 1% of the total 36,000 species of animal and plants. And in appendix three, those species are covered which are protected in at least one of the CITES party or countries. And this international trade in the species, which are included in the three appendices of the convention, has to follow at least three conditions. The first condition is legality, means all those species which are to be traded internationally, those must be legally obtained. And that is why, to ensure that those species or their parts, articles or derivatives are legally obtained, we the CITES Management Authority take the legal procurement certificate before issuance of the CITES permits. And the second point is regarding the sustainability, means the trade of the CITES listed species should be sustainable. And to ensure that the trade is sustainable, a non-detrimental finding is to be concluded by the scientific authorities of the CITES parties or nations. And the third point is regarding the traceability. So to ensure the traceability, party issue the CITES permit, and the CITES permit is transmitted from the issuing authority to the receiving authority so that the trade of those species can become traceable. And this is the diagram which shows the volume of the CITES listed international transaction. And as you can see that in 2018, more than 1.1 million transactions of CITES listed species has taken place between the different countries. So how the implementation of CITES takes place? So for implementation of CITES, so CITES works by subjecting international trade of the specimens of selected species to certain controls, and all import, export, re-export and introduction from the sea of species covered by the convention has to be authorized through a licensing system or the permit system. And each party to the convention must designate one or more management authorities in charge of administering that licensing system or the permit system, and one or more scientific authorities to advise them on the effects of trade on the status of the species. And as we all know that India joined CITES on the 20th July 1976 by way of ratification, and which came into force on the 18th October 1976. And as I discussed in the earlier slide, that कि नॉन डेटरिमेंटल फाइंडिंग बाय द साइंटिफिक अथॉरिटी इज मस्ट टू अलाउ द ट्रेड अंडर द साइटिस अपेंडिक्स टू लिस्ट एंड हु आर द साइंटिफिक अथॉरिटीज एज फार एज इंडिया इज कंसर्न सो देयर आर सेवन साइंटिफिक अथॉरिटीज इन इंडिया एज पर साइटिस साइट and these are geological survey of india botanical survey of india central marine fisheries research institute wildlife institute of india then institute of forest genetics and tree breeding and icfre dehradun and icfre jorhat assam and under the cites there is a provision of enforcement focal point and in respect of india it is wildlife crime control bureau that has been designated as the enforcement focal point so whenever there is any enforcement action takes place in respect of the CITES listed species at any exit point so that has to be reported to the enforcement focal point and regarding the management authorities so the ADG sir wildlife as well yeah, who is also the director of wildlife keep preservation and the ex officio director of the WCCB he is designated as the CITES management authority of india and there are four assistant CITES management authorities in India and they are the four regional deputy directors of the four regional offices of the wildlife crime control bureau which are located at New Delhi, Kolkata, Mumbai and Chennai and there is a concept of competent authorities so competent authorities are those authorities which are competent to issue the comparable documents in relation to the trade in species of Dalbergia species like Dalbergia sisu and Dalbergia latifolia which are included in appendix 2 for which India has entered a reservation and Mr. Rajesh Rawat has talked about in detail about this provision because apart from all the assistant management authority the director export promotion council for handicrafts is also one of the competent authority for the purpose of issuance of the comparable documents in respect of the Dalbergia species and these are the format of the CITES permit and this on the right side is the format of the comparable document and here on the left side is the format of the legal procurement certificate and once the assistant CITES management authority issue a CITES permit that CITES permit has to be uploaded on the customs platform of the e-Sanchit and an IRN number as well as the DRN number are generated and those IRN DRN numbers are communicated to the exporter and they have to mention those numbers while filing the shipping bill and on the basis of those numbers that CITES permit can be fetched by the customs platform ICEGATE and this is a book that was published by the geological survey of india called faunal diversity of indian himalaya in 2018 so as per this book politically the parts of himachal pradesh and jammu kashmir are classified under the northwest himalaya uttarakhand and some area of himachal pradesh are classified under the western himalaya then the hills of Darjeeling West Bengal and Sikkim are classified under central himalayas and the state of Arunachal Pradesh is classified under the eastern himalaya so only these states are relevant for today's presentation because we are talking about the CITES listed himalayan species and as per this book these 19 Pisces species 4 amphibian species 15 reptilia species and 52 AFC species as well as the 13 mammalia species are facing the threat of extinction as per the IUCN red list 2017 and these are the species which are found in the Indian Himalayas so Himalayan CITES listed fauna in trade so which are the fauna of Himalayan CITES listed species which are found in trade so after the data analytics of the wildlife crime for the last 3 years my finding is that one of the major species that is found in the Himalayan region and which is also CITES listed and which is very much in trade is the Himalayan brown bear as well as the Himalayan black bear. And these species are posed basically for their bear biles, which is much in demand for the TCM or the traditional Chinese medicine. And apart from their biles, they are also posed for their paws and the claws, which are used for the occult practices. And the next to Himalayan CITES listed species that is very much in trade is the Tibetan antelope. So these the wool that is derived from the Tibetan antelope is used for making the shatush shawls. And these shatush shawls has been or have been detected in many cases, mainly at the ICI Air Cargo Delhi as well as the Atari ICP in Punjab. And since 2017 till date, almost 39 cases of detection of the shatush shawls have taken place. And the next species is the musk deer. And musk deer is basically posed for its pod, which is used mainly in the perfume and the medicinal industry. And the next species is the snow leopard. And this is the skin of the snow leopard that was seized by the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, New Delhi, only 2-3 years back. And the next species is the common leopard. And common leopard is basically posed for their skin, their canines, as well as their claws. And the next species is the monal pheasants, which is also listed under CITES and found in the Himalayan region. So these the feeders of the monal pheasants are very much in demand for the purpose of using it in the fishing gear, which attracts the fishes. So these 5 or 6 species which are found in the Himalayan region and also are listed under CITES are found in trade. And now the Himalayan CITES listed flora, which are in trade. So they are basically ladies slipper orchids, then blue vanda plants, peacher plants. So these are 3 key plants, and then the 4 key medicinal plants. One is kuthroot, then jatamansi, kutki, and sarpagandha. And all these medicinal plants parts, basically their roots, and they are also detected in the form of oil as well as in the form of powder, basically at the exit points. So the seizure of the Himalayan CITES listed flora is basically made at the exit points. And those exit points are at the ICI Air Cargo New Delhi, Nava Sheva Port, Mundra Port, then LCS Petrapol, and CFS Kochi are the main exit points where the seizure of these Himalayan medicinal plants have been made. And then the local trade of the Himalayan aromatic and medicinal plants. So this is a research paper called Trade of Threatened Himalayan Medicinal and Aromatic Plants, Socioeconomy, Management and Conservation Issues in Garhwal, Himalayas, India, which was published in the Global Journal of Medical Research, Microbiology and Pathology in the year 2013. As per this research paper, the global demand of the aromatic as well as the medicinal plants is increasing day by day across the world. And the annual turnover of herbal medicine in India only is estimated at 177,000 metric tons, for which 960 plant species are in active trade. And on account of the high degree of the threat, CITES has already notified 11 Indian medicinal and aromatic plants in its appendices. And these are the 18 plant species which are basically found in the Western Himalayas, which are mostly in trade. And their potential zones are Harki Dun and Daira in the Uttarkashi district, Panvali Kantha in Tehri district, Madhya Maheshwar in Rudraprayag district, and Joshimath in Chamoli district. And this is the trade channel for the selected MAPZ in the Garhwal Himalayas. So when this plant species or the AMP species are collected from these potential zones by the local collectors.
Excuse me, Arvind, just a second. Arvind, sir. Your screen is not visible. Can you please check? Your slides are not visible.
Okay, slides are not visible, sir.
It is visible to me. I don't know. Ask the others. Mr. Rawat, is it visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible. It is visible, sir.
Maybe, Arvind, maybe Girish, okay, something wrong.
Please continue. Please continue.
It's visible.
Yeah, okay. So these are the 80 AMPs, aromatic and medicinal plants, which are found in the Western Himalayas of Garhwal region of Uttarakhand. And this is the trade channels for those MAPs. So once they are collected by the local collectors from their potential zones, they reaches into the hands of the local traders, from there the big traders, and from these big traders, those MAPs reaches to the regional wholesale markets. And these regional wholesale markets are located at Dehradun, Haridwar, Saharanpur, and Ramnagar. And from the regional wholesale markets, they reaches the national wholesale markets. And these national wholesale markets are located at Delhi, Amritsar, Kanpur, Calcutta, and Chennai. And from these regional as well as the national wholesale market, these AMPs reaches into the pharmaceutical industries as well as to the retail markets, and which are located at the Rishikesh and Badrinath. Now, a brief talk also on the cyber trafficking of the CITES listed flora. So, in the 23rd meeting of the plants committee of CITES that took place on the 22nd and 24th to 27th July 2017, they have mentioned about several species of CITES listed flora which are being traded on the digital platforms, mainly on the eBay and the Amazon. So these are almost 25 flora species which are CITES listed and which are found, and many of these species are found in the Himalaya region also, and they are being traded on the eBay and the Amazon also. And now this raises a point that we also need to do the cyber patrolling to find out the cyber trade of such flora species also. So at present, what is happening is that our focus is more on the fauna side and not towards the flora side. And we need to shift our focus towards the flora side also, as far as the cyber wildlife trafficking is concerned. And now the best international practices for CITES implementation. So the CITES Secretariat has proposed that all its member countries should adopt the eCITES, which aims at the information management and the automated processes to strengthen the implementation of the convention. And this is a map, and in this map, the countries which are shown in the green color are those countries which are still developing or planning to have some kind of electronic CITES permit system. And the countries which are shown in the light brown color are those countries which have already have some kind of eCITES permit system. So India falls in the category of those countries which are still developing or planning to have an electronic CITES permit system. And CITES Secretariat has also given implementation framework also and a practitioner guide to implement the electronic CITES permit. And as per this framework, the implementation of the eCITES system, which has been proposed by the CITES Secretariat, will be implemented in the four stages or four phases. So the first stage will be regarding the e-permit. So the e-permit or the first stage will be covering the request and issuance of e-permits electronically. So currently what is happening that the exporter applies to us for issuance of the of the CITES permit in a physical manner, and we issue the CITES permit in the physical manner. But once we adopt the eCITES system, then this process of application as well as the issuance of the CITES permit will go from physical mode to the digital mode. The second stage is regarding the e-control. So in this stage, what would happen that the permit information exchange with the customs means once the CITES management authority issues the CITES permit, that CITES permit will be electronically exchanged with the customs. So currently what we are doing is that after issuing the CITES permit, we are making the PDF file of that CITES permit and uploading it into the customs e-Sanchit platform. But after introduction of the e-CITES permit system, the e-CITES permit will automatically exchange in a digital manner from the e-CITES platform to the customs platform. And the third stage is regarding the e-report. So currently what is happening that we are compiling our annual CITES report as well as the illegal trade report and the biannual CITES implementation reports in a physical manner and we are sending it to the CITES secretariat. But after implementation of this e-CITES system, this process will also get automated and these reports will be generated into the digital manner as well as these reports will be transmitted to the CITES secretariat in a digital manner. And the last and the fourth stage is regarding the e-exchange of the CITES permits. Means once all the CITES management authorities are on board, the e-CITES permit system that has been proposed by the CITES secretariat. So once a CITES permit is issued by one CITES management authority, that will be electronically exchanged with the CITES management authority of the other countries. So it means there will be no physical intervention at all after completion of these four stages, and the entire ecosystem, right from the application stage to the sharing of the CITES permit with the other CITES management authority, will become totally digitized or the automated one. And the currently in the paper permit system, the flow chart is like this, that the exporter makes an application to the CITES management authority. CITES management authority issues the CITES permit and then the exporter sends that CITES permits to the importer and the importer then submit the CITES permit to the customs authorities. And if they have to verify whether the CITES permit submitted by the importer is genuine or not, they have to contact the CITES permit issuing authority in the importing country. But once the e-CITES permit system is implemented, the entire flow will become digitized. So once the exporter makes a request on the digital platform with the CITES management authority, they will issue the CITES permit to digitally. And the exporter will get the permit ID number. And the exporter will convey just the permit ID number to the importer. And the importer will mention that permit ID number into his customs document that he has filed in his importing country. And the customs or the CITES management authorities, on the basis of that CITES permit number, can automatically fetch that CITES permit from the e-CITES system that has been proposed by the CITES secretariat. And this is the this is the dashboard of the e-CITES permitting system that has been proposed by the CITES secretariat, and this will be working on the ACQDA platform. So ACQDA platform is the automated system of customs data management. So once we are part of this system and we logging to the URL of this e-CITES@acqda.org, this window will open and there is an option called connect to e-CITES. So when we click on the connect to e-CITES, this they will show the countries which have already
Arvind, adopted. I think you have to, now it's getting maybe 1 or 2 minutes, you need to wind up.
Yes ma'am, sure ma'am. So So once we connect to, so when we connect to these ITs, then the list of the countries which have already adopted this eCIT system will be shown. So the currently only the Sri Lanka has adopted this eCIT permitting system, and that is why here only one country, Sri Lanka, is being shown. So once we click on the Sri Lanka, then this window will open and they have to log in. And once they log in, this dashboard will open, and on this dashboard they can get the digital application from the exporter, and they can issue the CITES permit digitally to the exporter. And since there will be a QR code also, so the importing country CITES management authority or the customs authority can just scan this QR code and they can verify the genuinity of the CITES permit. And similarly, the United Arab Emirates has also adopted the eCITES permit system, but their eCITES permit system is not the same as has been proposed by the CITES secretariat. They have developed their own eCITES permit system, and which has come into force from the 2nd February to 2021. So this is a sample copy of the CITES permit that we have received from the Dubai CITES Management Authority. And there is a QR code, and when we scan this QR code with any barcode reader, this QR code takes us to this link. And when we click on the link, so this window opens, and here the CITES permit number is given. And when we enter the CAPTCHA here and then click send, so we can download the entire original CITES permit from the eCITES database of the United Arab Emirates CITES Management Authority. So here there will be no physical interface between the CITES Management Authority of the importing country as well as the exporting country. It can be verified in a digital manner itself, and that will further strengthen the implementation of CITES across the countries. So yeah, that's all from my side. I think I completed within the time slot. Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so very much, sir, for your detailed and completely enlightening session on the topic. It was really an enriching experience to attend the session. Thank you, sir. So following these intriguing sessions, I would like now to hand over the virtual floor to Sri H.V. Girisha, the Joint Director of Wildlife Crime Control Bureau. Sir is an Indian Forest Service officer of the 2004 batch belonging to Uttar Pradesh cadre. I would now request him to kindly take command of the virtual platform and moderate the upcoming panel discussion. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Arnav. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Welcome all again. Today we have with us for panel discussion three former stakeholders, Mr. Siddharth Singh Negi from Uttarakhand, and Mr. Nandlal Sharma from Himachal Pradesh, and Mr. Syed Abdul Khami from Assam. And we also have nodal officers of Secure Himalaya project from the high altitude Himalayas, Mr. Sri Anil Thakur, additional PCC of wildlife from Himachal Pradesh, and Sri Uday Gurung, conservator forest wildlife from Sikkim. And we also have a knowledge partner of UNDP in this Secure Himalaya project, Mr. Marvin, Dr. Marvin from Traffic India, and Mr. Jose Lewis from Wildlife Trust of India. Of course, we have both the speakers of today on the panel. So this panel discussion to share your views and experience with the audience of this August gathering. In the beginning, I just would like to request Mr. Syed Abdul Khami. Khami is from Assam, has been associated with the agarwood industry for last 25 years. He is known for his initiatives to take this trade in agarwood forward in many fronts from India. I would request Syed Abdul Khami to share his experiences with us of his journey of 25 years to take this agarwood trade forward from India to the rest of the world. Over to you, Mr. Khan. Please unmute yourself up and speak for us.
Hello, namaskar to everyone. I think everyone can hear me.
Yeah, please go ahead. We can hear you. Yeah. If you can switch on your video also, that would be wonderful.
Yeah, my video, I think.
Please go ahead. We can hear you.
This has been quite a long journey, but the main thing is that I've been working with this agarwood thing for the last 25 years. And as you know, agarwood was included into Appendix 2 of CITES on a request by India in 1994. And the previous report on the basis of which agarwood was included into CITES Appendix 2 was a report from TRAFIC India. So TRAFIC did some groundwork, and then finally the proposal was made, and in 1994 agarwood was included. And sadly, all throughout these years, agarwood has, the trade of agarwood has moved from forest collection or you know, from wildlife to plantation. And in all these 25 years, in other countries as well, agarwood plantations have come up in a very big way. But sadly, till date, India has not been able to export even 1 kilo of agarwood, indigenous cultivated agarwood, because of certain hassles in the process. Because there's the, as you know, after the Goda, this 19, 2000, this case, all states were required to have this wood-based industries rules. So agarwood being a cottage industry, it moved, it had to be moved to a notified area. So a lot of people didn't do with that. So, you know, we had lots of difficulties. And that is what the real thing is, that though I have been associated with it, I have attended many COP meetings. There was a CITES workshop here in Guwahati itself. The CITES secretariat in 2015, Negi sir was there from the WCCB, and Mr. Vijit Rajchaudhary was also there. But the thing is that the gap is still there. That's all I'm interested in.
Thank you very much, Khavi, for your wonderful inputs. Appreciated your long journey in taking this straight forward. Now I would request Mr. Marvin Fernandes. As Mr. Khavi said, TRAFIC had a great contribution in identifying the agar and take it to the COP meet to include that in the CITES as well as then promoting the trade in agar. Dr. Marvin, we would like to hear from you, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving us this platform. So the initial consent report that was presented then was timely for the species in general. When you look at it, most of the species, what rightly said, is now it's been cultivated and not sourced in the wild. Many of the wild populations itself has been depleted. With CITES, there is a provisions also with the certificate to show that the origins are not from the wild but from cultivated sources, and you can still take it because it is Appendix 2. It is not wild. So Appendix 2 still allows regulated trade in that species. So the other hurdles being what Abhi said is like, are the processes in place for management authorities and even for validating authorities to take this up? The other two processes for CITES implementation is the NDF and the RSC, which needs to come along with it, and traceability. So traceability does not mean a document, it means actually from the provenance from where that species is coming. So if we have these other processes in place, I do not see why India is still not being able to trade despite being the species in Appendix 2. There are some lacunae in which how we are understanding it. It doesn't mean that the trade is stopped. It is regulated, it is still permissible, and we would like to see that how we can take this powder, especially in Azerbaijan's case. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mervin. Yes, it is true, although it is in Appendix 2. Because of the policies, we were unable to do it. Anyway, states are coming up with new policies, and the Government of India is also in favor of it. Hopefully, we will start sustainably harvesting the agar as per the non-detriment reports that we have read recently. So thank you very much for that valuable. May I now request Sri Anil Thakur sir, who is additional PCCF for wildlife from Himachal Pradesh. Sir, we have a clientele from Himachal Pradesh who actually trade the kut, and they have been doing it from last two decades as per the reports with us. So kindly throw some light on this, sir. Maybe some gaps are existing, or how we can facilitate this trade in higher altitudes of Himalayas. Over to you, sir. Sri Anil Thakur.
Thank you, Girish. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Perfectly audible, sir. Please, please. Sir, we lost you. I think you can close your video and speak, sir. I think you have very low bandwidth. Well, meanwhile, sir has some problem with network. And meanwhile, I think we get connect to Mr. Uday Gurung, Conservator of Forest Wildlife from the state of Sikkim. Sir, we have lot many species of orchids in Sikkim, and this is a repository of hundreds of orchid varieties in Sikkim. Could you please throw some light on the orchid species that are in CITES trade in India? Over to you, sir. Sri Uday Gurung.
Good afternoon, everybody. Sikkim, as everybody knows, is a small state, tiny Himalayan landlocked state. As the saying goes, this world is always beautiful. Spread over an area of 7,096 square kilometer only. Sorry, because of the poor bandwidth, I'm not opening my video. We have, in a national average of total geographical area, we have just 0.22%, and our state is a home, a repository to 26% of total country's overall biodiversity. The state is located in the Himalayan Global Biodiversity Hotspot and has international borders with, on its three sides, Nepal in the west, Bhutan in the east, and in the north, we have Tibet Autonomous Region and China. And the southern side, we have the neighboring state, West Bengal. And this makes it extremely important for transboundary monitoring and enforcement of entire Northeast region. As mentioned, the international borders surrounding Sikkim are mostly porous and located in remote high altitude mountain, which are mostly inhabited by military or paramilitary organizations. In the recent past, we had poaching, the cases of seizure of sea horses from the Nathula border of China, wherein like the illegal trade corridor extends through West Bengal to Nepal, Bhutan, and even further Southeast Asian countries. Coming to the point, as sir has mentioned about the orchid species, which are CITES lucidae species, Phalaenopsis, this lady slipper orchid are very common, and like They are in very high demand because of this of its beauty. In the state of Sikkim, we have a conservation reserve for Phalaenopsis. Phalaenopsis. That will be developed species and some Phalaenopsis. And under the project Sikkim Himalaya, I'm one of the nodal, I'm the nodal officer for the state of Sikkim also. So thanks to Dr. Modern and team Traffic India for submitting and charting out the major constraints in a very elaborate manner. And they have a very comprehensive report and have submitted recommendations for combating wildlife offense in the state. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Gurung, for that wonderful inputs. Yes, Sikkim has a lot of problems. At the same time, yes, as you submitted, it is the repository of very rich biodiversity. Thank you for the inputs. Now we will request Mr. Jose Luis from Wildlife Trust of India. You have been the knowledge partner with the UNDP for Ladakh landscape. You have studied a lot in this landscape. You have recorded a lot of many species that are in trade, legally and illegally. Could you please share your experiences of your study so that you know rest of us get benefited out of it? Over to you, Mr. Jose.
Thank you, sir, and really thanking for this opportunity to share our findings, sir. During our short study in the Leh Ladakh region, one thing what I would like to highlight here is that there are a number of medicinal plants which are listed in CITES but not protected under Wildlife Protection Act, and there is a difficulty of law implementing the provisions of the law at ground level by the frontline staff. Because what I believe in is that instead of waiting for the material to reach the border checkpoints and you know, in different formats, that's something which we also found out, that you know, many of these medicinal plants move from the source area to places like Amritsar in Punjab and convert into ingredients in medicines or in different formats and then getting exported. So we need to look at you know, plants which are protected in CITES. There has to be a move to protect them under the provisions of the Wildlife Protection Act, so that there is ground level protection can be given to plants. So that's very important. And during our study, we came across with large quantities of you know, plant being collected, and local enforcement agencies not able to, you know, take cognizance of the offense because it is not protected under the laws of the country. The other major thing I would like to bring everybody's attention is the trade in Shatush, where the shawl is getting exported and the wool is coming in. So it's an interesting situation where a CITES protected, Schedule 1 protected under Wildlife Protection Act material is coming into the landscape and getting out of the landscape. So this needs a very serious attention, and we need law enforcement in this particular direction. That's all, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose, for that wonderful input. Yes, of course, we also keep a tab on this particular species, which has just really attracted international attention. So thank you very much. Now we will switch on to Mr. Nandlal Sharma. Nandlal Sharma is a farmer and a trader from Manali, Himachal Pradesh. He is into cultivation of Sasuriya costa, so he's got good, since 2005, and he is into the CITES trade for almost 1.5 decade, and he has been exporting his products to Switzerland, Spain, Yemen, France, and Germany. Apart from this Sasuriya costas, so he is also in the trade of the CITES listed Photophyllum hexantrum as well as Piperorhizia corua. Mr. Nandlal Sharma, please take the floor to explain us how you started this business and what are the difficulties that you must have faced, and how WCCB or the CITES management authorities are assisting you in taking your trade forward. to reach to all these countries. Over to you, Mr. Sharma. Can you hear us, Mr. Nanda Sharma? Well, I think he has some connectivity problem. Let us continue this and let us reach out to Mr. Siddharth Singh Negi. Siddharth Singh Negi is another farmer who is into cultivation of Cytis listed species, again, cutthroat. He is from Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. And he is associated with the society kind of a thing called Kamgar Swayat Sahakarita. So wherein it is, they work as a cooperative society, collect all the cultivated kut roots and then trade it, export it. And he is also associated with a civil society called Uttaranchal Youth Rural Development Center, which is working for sustained mountain ecosystem development. Mr. Siddharth Singh Negi, over to you, please. We want to listen to you.
So, so thank you so much, sir, for having invited us to this August session on a webinar. And I'm so really happy that such a pivotal subject has been spoken about. We as a farmers cooperative have been operational since 2006, and it has been a long journey since we received some philanthropic support from TIFEC, Technical Information Forecasting Assessment Council, with ABLE apex body of ICAR and IAR, and then on the various other stakeholders came in who guided us through. And HAPREC, High Altitude Plant Physiology Research Center, based in Srinagar Gadwal University, HNB Bahuguna University, and HRDI. So HRDI is the facilitating body for the farmers at the state level. HRDI is Herbal Research Development Institute. So the farmers have been registered at the HRDI, with the HRDI, and the transit permit has been given to the farmers whenever they are able to harvest their produce and sell it in the national market and in the international market. Firstly, I would also like to thank Wildlife Crime Control Bureau for being so very kind all the time whenever we have approached them, and they have guided us through. And that is only the way how we have been able to receive the permit, and we have been able to sell our farmer produce to the overseas market. I have two cases over here which I would definitely want to voice or highlight. One of our clients, for example, Banyan Trading Company, they have been applying to the NBA for clearances for seeking ABS since 2018, and the file is still in the process, and they have not been able to have an agreement with the NBA. So in such cases wherein the permission for the permit for the overseas buyer becomes a necessity at the CITES office, it becomes difficult for the farmers to sell their produce unless and until there's a permission being given. But on a courtesy basis, it was kind of the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau that whenever we have approached them, we have been able to receive the permit, and that is the only way we have been able to sell our herbs to the international market. And also there is the other case is that for a CITES listed species from the cultivated source, after being harvested, it has to go through the transit permit being provided by the Herbal Research Development Institute and joint supervision by the Forest Department. And then on, we go to the DFO office, and there we get the legal procurement certificate. And it is on the basis of legal procurement certificate that the CITES permit has been given. So it is possible for us as a farmers cooperative, and it is also possible for us as a society to be able to mobilize ourselves. But it becomes very difficult in case it is any other farmer organization that doesn't have a communication situation to be able to communicate with the state ministries and the central ministries. So therefore, that is a criticality. And also, when the farmer is cultivating the CITES listed appendix 1 species, that is coot, the protocols for trade-off in the international market is different. So there, the DFO is not the one who has to give the legal procurement certificate. I guess we have to then go to Dehradun and try to pursue the chief wildlife warden to be able to issue to us the certificate on the basis of which the CITES would be given. So there is a need definitely for easing this process. And we have been, I think there is a pertinent need for a single window clearance, if that could be a possibility, wherein the farmers cooperative, a true farmers cooperative, can seek for clearances at the local level itself. Maybe wherever in the block he is, he can just file an application and request for all the certifications, if possible, to be given to him for being able to trade off his coot, kutki, atish, jatamasi, and all that thing. So that would lead to a more propagation of these endangered herbs in the cultivation areas, and being able to encourage the farmers to enter into a more fruitful engagement, because the Indian market is not really that friendly. At times, it is also fair, it is also unfair. A lot is unfair. So therefore, that really needs to be looked at. So I would just leave it to this. But thank you so very much for inviting us to this August occasion. And I look forward to a more easing proceduralization of permissions, which would lead to a very encouraging atmosphere for endeavors in cultivation of endangered herbs. Thank you so very much, sir, for having invited us. And thank you, everybody. Namaste, and reverences and greetings from the Himalayas. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Siddharth. You have given very valuable inputs for us. I am sure that UNDP officials participating in the webinar must have taken a note of the requirement of single window clearance system for the farmers who are involved in the CITES trade in higher altitude of Himalayas, and also the transit issues and HRDI issues have been noted down, and certainly we will take up these issues, and we will discuss with you in the near future to ease out this business process of CITES trade. So thank you very much for joining us and giving your valuable. Now, I would like to request Anil Thakur, sir. Sir is back. Sir, over to you. I have already introduced. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Girish. I think now I am audible. Okay.
So perfect. Thank you, sir.
You were talking about Sosoria or Kut. It's an export from Himachal Pradesh. This species is mainly. I think there's again a problem with network again. Am I audible now?
Sir, you are audible, sir. You can keep your video off.
This Sosoria species, it is exported from Himachal Pradesh Lahol area, and this herb is cultivated there in the field of farmers, and there is no export from the forest area. for this, the farmer has to apply to the local DFO for registration for cultivation. And once it is registered, and the herb is extracted from the field, then wildlife Inc. is authorized to give export permit. The CCF wildlife, there are three CCF wildlife in Himachal. One is at Shimla, then one is at Shamshi, and other is at Dharamshala. So they are authorized to give export permit for this Sosoria for export, which is under CITES, and that is how the process goes on in Himachal. There is very less availability of this Sosoria in wild. It is mainly from cultivated source, and it is only that that is exported from the cultivated lands only. So this was the about Sosoria, and other species which are traded in Himachal, they are they may not be in CITES. They are Nagchatri, Patish, Kadu, and one lasun from Pangi area, which is a secure landscape. From Lahol area, then there is again Nagchatri, Patish, Kadu, and one lasun. And in Kinnaur, the species is almost similar, that is Nagchatri, Patish, Kadu, and Val Hasun. These are the species which are traded, and many times there is over-exploitation of the species also. And the volume normally for which the export permit is given, extra quantities also are reported to have been are taken out from the areas. So under assignment under secure, we have also got study done from Traffic India, and to help the forest staff and other functionaries, number of workshops, trainings have also been organized, so that they find it easy to tackle the offenses which is related to wildlife crime or trade offs these species which are endangered or threatened, covered under CITES. So we are also looking forward that the some volunteer scheme is also there from the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, for which some applications have been sent to this office also for verification. These volunteers will also help in tackling the wildlife crime and trade in these restricted species. So we look forward for more trainings, workshops related to CITES, so that we are more acquainted with the issues of CITES, and field staff is also aware of the provisions and their duties in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for letting us know the process of CITES clearances adopted in Himachal Pradesh. Also, sir, we have taken a note of the requirement of trainings in handling CITES issues for Himachal forest officials. Certainly, we will check out some program where we. The knowledge partners of UNDP, Mr. Bhavin, is also here, who has actually studied the landscape of Himachal. I think, sir, we will look forward to check out a training program in CITES issues. Thank you very much, sir. Now we have with us Mr. Nandlal Sharma. Mr. Sharma, I have already introduced you to the audience here. Please take the floor. We just want to listen from you about your experiences in CITES trade of the species that you are dealing with. Over to you, Mr. Sharma. You have to unmute. You are muted.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir.
Please go ahead. Sunai there.
हाँ जी सर, सबसे पहले मेरी ओर से नमस्कार सब सबको।
अब मैं हिंदी में देना चाहूंगा सर अपना विचार।
मैं बोलिए, हिंदी मातृभाषा है हमारा, हिंदी में बोलिए, सभी समझेंगे।
मैं सर 2005 से अपने खेतों में ये इंडेंजर्ड स्पीसीज ग्रो कर रहा हूँ। थैंक्स पीसीसी ऑफ वाइल्ड लाइफ शिमला, जिन्होंने मुझे इसके बारे में गाइडेंस किया और मुझे परमिशन दी और मेरी रजिस्ट्रेशन करवाया। तो 2005 से लेकर टिल डेट मैं इस स्पीसीज को ग्रो भी कर रहा हूँ और साथ में इसकी ट्रेड भी कर रहा हूँ, एक्सपोर्ट भी कर रहा हूँ। अब थोड़ा काफ़ी समय हो गया इस स्पीसीज को एक्सपोर्ट करते हुए, तो हम लोग कुछ और स्पीसीज के ऊपर भी हम जा रहे हैं, जैसे अभी बात चल रही थी पिक्रोजा कुरुआ और फोडोफलमेक्सेंड्रम, ये अपेंडिक्स टू में आते हैं पर आते ये साइटिस के अंदर, तो इसके लिए भी एलपीसी जो है रिक्वायर्ड है। तो इंटरनेशनल मार्केट में ये दोनों स्पीसीज की डिमांड तो है, पर लीगल वे से इसको एक्सपोर्ट करने वाला इंडिया में बहुत कम लोग हैं। तो हम कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि इन स्पीसीज को भी अपने यहाँ प्रोड्यूस करके एक्सपोर्ट करें, ताकि ये हमारे जो लाइवलीहुड में ये जो क्रॉप है कुछ सहयोग कर सके, क्योंकि इंटरनेशनल मार्केट में दाम अच्छा मिलता है, डोमेस्टिक मार्केट में हेरासमेंट बहुत ज़्यादा रहता है। तो मटेरियल बाय करने के बाद भी प्रॉपरली पेमेंट जो कमिटमेंट करते हैं फार्मेसी वाले, मिडल मैन वाले, तो वो एकदम से पेमेंट देते नहीं है, ब्रेक ब्रेक करके देते हैं। तो उससे जो दूसरा जो हम लोग जो ग्रोवर हैं, तो हम लोगों के काम में बड़ी दिक्कतें आती है। तो ये आपके डिपार्टमेंट साइंटिस्ट दिल्ली का भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूँ, जिन्होंने मुझे हर टाइम अच्छा सहयोग दिया। जब भी मेरे पेपर्स आए तो इन टाइम मुझे पेपर देके मेरे कंसाइनमेंट को मेरे फाइनल डेस्टिनेशन तक पहुँचाने में मेरा सहयोग दिया, इसके लिए मैं बहुत बहुत आभारी हूँ आप सब लोगों का। तो बाकी इतना ही कहना चाह रहा हूँ सर, बाकी मेरे पास कुछ ऐसा कुछ नहीं है। थैंक यू,
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद शर्मा साहब, आपने बड़ा संक्षिप्त रूप में अपना सारे एक्सपीरियंसेस हमारे सामने रखा है। आगे भी यदि हमसे कोई अपेक्षा है, कोई सहायता की जरूरत है आपकी ट्रेड को प्रमोट करने के लिए, निश्चित रूप से हम अपना आपके साथ देंगे। तो धन्यवाद आपके लिए। वी आर ऑलमोस्ट एट द एंड ऑफ दिस पैनल डिस्कशन। वी हैव विद अस बोथ द स्पीकर्स टुडे, मिस्टर अरविंद एज वेल एज मिस्टर राजेश। आई वुड लाइक टू टेक द व्यूज ऑफ दिस पैनल डिस्कशन एट द एंड वन बाय वन। ओवर टू यू मिस्टर अरविंद फर्स्ट। You can just take 2 minutes to sum up what express your views about what we have discussed till now. Over to you, Mr. Arvind. Well, till Arvind joins, I would request Mr. Rajesh Rawat. Actually, we should have had a few traders who are using EPCH platform as well. But suddenly, we will remember this for the next time. But before that, I would just like to request you to express your opinion upon whatever we have discussed so far in the panel. Over to you, Mr. Rajesh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, a lot has been said about the trade which is happening in the CITES species. There are species which are in Appendix 3. I mean, we don't need any certification for that. There's a regulated trade as far as CITES, Appendix 2 of the CITES species concerned. And we at TPCH are helping our member exporters facilitate the exports of wooden handicraft made from the sesame wood. Now, my only thing is, which I would like to put before the panel who's here. Since I told you that we had we went to the COP18 meeting, and there's a proposal for a delisting of the Dalbergia sishu species from Appendix 2 of the CITES, and non-detrimental finding species study we have been talking about, that has also been done, because that forms the basis of delisting of any item from the restricted list. So that has been, that has also been done. But I would urge the ministry here to strongly put forward the case for delisting, because sisham is a kind of wood which is in abundance in the country. Ms. Verma is here with us. She would agree that sisham wood is found everywhere in the villages, on the sides of the highways, and everywhere. So there is no threat, which is also being proven by the non-detrimental finding study, which was done by Botanical Survey of India. So we should put forward our case in the CITES body, which is a multilateral organization, that there are certain species which are somehow got listed where they shouldn't be. So this is my only request. And if we are able to do it, we'll able to see. We have a huge forest mechanism, which is a forest machinery in the country, which looks after the conservation and protection of the forest. So there is a system out here in the country which is not developed in one day. It is more than 100 years it has been in place. So things are in place. The conservation is good. The forest cover is good. So India is always pro-conservation. But when the livelihood of the individuals are affected, when the trade is getting hampered in such a way that where less items are listed where they should be, so we should put forward our case more vociferously. So that is my only submission. Thank you, sir, and thank you again for inviting me to this panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rajesh. You made your point. We understood. Definitely, we will fight it together. Thank you very much for sharing your opinions. Now we have come to the end of the panel discussion. That is all in the panel. Now, over to you, Ms. Urjasvi and Arnav. Take the floor, please.
Thank you so much, Girisha, sir, and all the panelists for such an intriguing discussion on the implementation of CITES. This brings us almost to the end of our webinar today. I would like to request Ms. Tilotama Verma, Additional Director, WCCB, for the concluding remarks, please. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you once again. I think the discussions have been very, very fruitful, and I must compliment Girish for having put together a panel of people from different walks of life. You know, government officials bhi the, hamare farmers bhi the, EPCH ke members bhi the, and even experts from other, for example, Mervin was there, Joes was there, who's been working in this area. So I'm extremely grateful, first of all, to my own team to have conceptualized this and got us all together here. And besides that, I'm also grateful to our ADG Wildlife, who put across very clearly that aaj ki tarikh mein... Can you hear? Rajesh Rawatji?
Yes, ma'am, I can hear.
Okay, fine. So I'd also like to mention, and grateful again to ADG Wildlife for having very clearly mentioned ki aaj ki tarikh mein our wildlife is under major threat, and it is affecting negatively our local communities. He spoke of its international trade, its nature, linked to insurgent groups, spoke of India as a major target, spoke of the vulnerability of the tiger, snow leopard, etc., spoke of need for stricter provisions of law and implementation of CITE. Despite stringent laws, he mentioned that there is still a big problem as far as demand is coming from Southeast Asian countries. And also he spoke the need of cooperation from other major groups, for example, Interpol, SAVAN, and CITES. And of course, all this beside mentioning this, I'm also extremely grateful to Mr. Rajesh Rawat for having come here on this board and spoken about the importance of RICSH and the area of work that EPCH is doing. And I also would like to reassure you that last time in the COP, the Government of India, Ministry of Agriculture, as well as our own ministry, unhone bahut koshish ki thi COP ke forum ke samne ye rakhne ke liye ki bhai hamara Dalbergia species ko aap appendix se hata dijiye aur delist kariye. और उसी की वजह से वी हैव आल्सो डन द नॉन डेट्रिमेंटल फाइंडिंग्स एंड बट दे ओनली रिलेटेड टू द फैक्ट दैट वी आप 10 किलो पर पर्सन आप व्हाट इज देयर वुड में 10 किलो क्या होता है मतलब इट इज मीनिंगलेस बट वी आर होपफुल दैट मे बी विद ग्रेटर प्रेशर एंड आई वुड सजेस्ट greater homework you know it is not only us but we also need to get other countries on board because wahan par bahut anya countries ka aapke sath jo support hota hai wo bahut important ho jata hai so I hope next cop se pehle we will do this homework so that we get a better result from cop the I would also like to thank Arvind who has I think put in lot of hard work in trying to understand this whole process and also put it together and also he Hey, one thing जो उन्होंने हमारे सामने प्रोजेक्ट किया वॉज द ई साइटस यू नो हमारे को मूव करना पड़ेगा इफ यू वॉन्ट बेटर सिस्टम टू बी इन प्लेस दैट हम ई साइटस की ओर मूव करें सो दैट थिंग्स बिकम स्पीडियर तो इसके लिए आई एम श्योर गिरीश आज के तारीख में ही इज हेडिंग दिस एंड आई एम श्योर दैट ही वुड बी वुड हैव अंडरस्टूड द इशू एंड वी विल लुक टूवर्ड्स दैट आई वुड ऑल्सो लाइक टू थैंक मिस्टर सैयद अब्दुल कामी जी ही ऑफकोर्स हैज बीन एसोसिएटेड विद अगरवुड Now I understand in the present state of affairs in Assam, they are also very, very keen to export more and more of agarwood because of the cultivated agarwood that is being cultivated. And he also spoke of the difficulties which are lying, but I'm sure the government of Assam and the central government are together trying to work on this so that we have lesser problem. But also at the same time, Sayyid Abdul Kami ji, main ye bhi kehna chahungi ke ye hamare कम्युनिटी के प्रेशर भी बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है क्योंकि अगर मैं 2000 अभी जो पिछले 2005-6-7 से लेकर आज की तारीख में देख ली थी तो जितना भी हमारा अगरवुड इलीगली जा रहा है और जो इलीगली एयरपोर्ट्स पर पकड़ा जा रहा है चाहे वो मेरा दिल्ली का एयरपोर्ट है चाहे वो मुंबई का एयरपोर्ट है चाहे वो हैदराबाद का एयरपोर्ट है और पकड़ने के बाद पता चलता है वो ट्रैक वापस गुवाहाटी और वेस्ट बंगाल को हो रहा है आई कैन ऑल्सो स्पेसिफिकली नेम प्लेसेस जहाँ से हो रहा है तो यदि आप हम लोग ये चाहते हैं कि भाई ये फ्री ट्रेड हो तो इसमें हमें कम्युनिटी पर भी प्रेशर डालना पड़ेगा कि इलीगली इस तरीके से नहीं ये चीजें मतलब दीज आर कम्युनिटी एफर्ट्स यू नो कम्युनिटी अवेयरनेस कि इस तरीके से आप करेंगे तो कहीं कहीं रिस्ट्रिक्शंस और लीगल रिस्ट्रिक्शंस हम पर लग जाएंगे तो आई वुड ऑल्सो अर्ज अपॉन विद योर एक्सपीरियंस दैट लेट अस वर्क टुगेदर लेट अस together work WCCB US enforcement agencies to reach out to all these people you know that we need to stop this illegal trade which is happening out from certain regions of Assam I'll also like to thank Mr. Gurung who is out here he very well highlighted the importance of the rich biodiversity of Sikkim and also laid out the fact that they are you know surrounded by countries and it is so very very easy to trade so apne jo herbs hai species hai wahan par wo to nikal hi rahi hongi par agar aapke sea horses jo andaman waters mein ya aapke lakshadweep se aate hain wo bhi nepal ke zariye aapke madhyam se gaye hain so it is but obvious that yes we need to collaborate more and more on the enforcement action Jose I am again grateful to you you have supported us a lot Girish often informs you of the sort of support that we have got in JNK by the study that you have done and I'm also very very concerned about Shetush I hope in the coming times we are able to reach out to the people from as to why Shetush is still coming into the illegal market and you also emphasized upon the importance that you know there are a lot of medicinal plants which are in situs which still have not come under the Wildlife Protection Act. I am sure the amendment to the Wildlife Protection Act should, in the near future, take care of this also. Mr. Siddharth Singh Negi, I think you spoke of a very very important thing. जहाँ आज हम लोगों ने बहुत सारा समय इस बात के लिए दिया, we gave a lot of time to e-permits, you know, situs e-permit, you know. But situs e-permit we are looking from the point of view from the states. के states से हमारे पास पहुँच जाएगा. और हम उसको वायबल बना देंगे बट जल्दी कर देंगे बट हमारे स्टेट्स में कितना टाइम लग रहा है उसको हम तक पहुंचने में आई थिंक दैट आल्सो रियली नीड्स टू बी रिवाइज्ड एंड इन वन बिग कंट्रीब्यूशन इफ दिस हिमालयन प्रोजेक्ट कैन डू इज लुक एट ऑल द फाइव स्टेट्स यू नो द साइटस परमिट्स द प्रोसेसेस ऑफ साइटस परमिट्स एंड व्हिच आर द गुड यू नो गुड प्रैक्टिसेस इन एनी ऑफ द स्टेट्स व्हिच देन वी कैन यू नो इंप्लीमेंट इन द अदर स्टेट्स और हैव अ यूनिफाइड सिस्टम टू इंश्योर दैट हाउ आर वी गोइंग टू यू नो get over with these timelines that are happening. So I think this is one area that we really need to work together on. And I'm extremely grateful to Mr. Anil Thakur, in spite of the problem that you are having the network. You gave us very, very useful suggestions, spoke of the type how kut was being exported. You also spoke of the other species, you know, that probably are now, that can be marketed out. And we under the UNDP Nets program is reaching out to communities to make livelihoods for them. Or agar jaise end mein, नंदला शर्मा जी ने कहा कि खुद के अलावा अन्य वेराइटीज भी उन्होंने देखी है जो मार्केट हो सकती है, आई थिंक यूएनडीपी को दे शुड टेक इट अप इमीडिएटली दैट ये वेराइटीज हैं तो हम इनको सपोर्ट कैसे कर सकते हैं. जो नंदलाल जी ने देखी और हिमाचल में अन्य वेराइटीज आई हैं, अगर हम इनको सपोर्ट कर सकते हैं तो जो कम्युनिटी जो हम लोग प्रोग्राम है जहाँ पर हम उनके लाइवलीहुड की स्कीम को देख रहे हैं, आई थिंक दिस शुड बी डेफिनेटली अ वेरी वेरी गुड इनिशिएटिव. सो आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू. ये आज की तारीख में मेरा मानना है कि बहुत अच्छा वेबिनार रहा, क्योंकि हम इन्फोर्समेंट ऑफिसर से हटकर अपने उन लोगों तक पहुंच पाए जो जिनके पास मैं समझती हूँ हमसे ज्यादा नॉलेज है, जो हमको ज्यादा अच्छे सुझाव दे सकते हैं, क्योंकि आपकी रोजी रोटी इस पर निर्भर है, हम तो एक माध्यम है. तो जहाँ तक आपका इंटरेक्शन आपके सुझाव है वो बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है. एंड पुनः मैं आप सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करती हूँ एंड एक्सट्रीमली ग्रेटफुल टू ऑल द टीम हियर टुडे, रिरीश, अर्नव, हु पुट इट ऑल टुगेदर, who's probably supposed to be taking a train today to leave for the next destination jahan usko jana hai, and Urjavashi, a young girl who's here, bahut acha aapne coordinate kiya. Grateful to one and all. And Ruchi is not here today, she was to join us but unfortunately because of her flight timing she could not join here. Rishipan, who is heading this project, I'm extremely grateful to her also. I'm very sorry if I have left out anybody, if I have left out our team from UNDP, of course needs all the credits, and I'm grateful to one and all once again. Thank you so much, Mervin, Jishu has been very, very has done a lot of work here, and Jose, of course, thank you once again, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, ma'am.
With this, we end our today's webinar and hope you join for the upcoming webinars in this series that we'll be conducting over 4th, 5th, and 6th of October. Thank you so much.